Thank you for coming this morning to celebrate the life and legacy of Bob Leader. My sin that certainly describes Bob Leader, even though he went through a lot of difficult times. I don't think there was a day he couldn't say, "It's well with my soul." He had a great relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ, and he had a Heavenly Father that he believed in. And so he knew that if anything and when anything happened to him, he would wake up in their presence. And those of us who know Christ as our personal Savior can say that. Everything's well with my soul. That's how to go through life. You can face the most dire circumstances that comes your way. I'd like to read the obituary. Robert Bob Leader, at age 66, passed away at his home, surrounded by his loving family, on December the 22nd, 2021. He was born in St. Joseph, Missouri, on October 27th, 1955, to Morris R. and Hazel M. Leader. On March the 3rd, 1992, Robert married the love of his life, Charity Matula Leader, in Lusaka, Zambia, Africa. She survives the home. And Bob was a faithful member here, was always here. If he could make it, he was at church. He lived every day for the Lord and his wife, kids, grandkids, whom he loved more than anything in this world. His family was his pride and joy. Bob was the pastor of Ray Union Church. He served as a missionary in Zambia, Africa for 3 years. He retired from Old Dominion Freight Lines after 20 years. Additional survivors are son Travis, Tina Leader, daughters Holly Leader, Shauna and Dylan Perry, grandchildren Caitlin, Braden, Jace Leader, and Lily Leader, Josiah, Jude, and Audrey Perry. Robert's mother, Hazel Leader. Siblings, Steve Leader, Margaret Wilson, Kathy Leader, Richard and Rita Leader, Lori and David Marshall, many nephews, nieces, cousins, great nephews, and great nieces. Bob was preceded in death by his father, Morris Leader, mother-in-law, Grace, and father-in-law, Ernest Nyanda. Three angel babies, niece Shelby Wilson, nephew Chase Leader, and grandparents. I'm going to ask Dylan, if you'd come at this time and share some thoughts.
Throughout this whole thing we've been going through, there's been multiple times where God's just shown himself in just the weirdest ways. And Charity and I were talking about that last night. So even though it's hard, we know he's there with us. And it was just another thing that happened this morning. I get a daily verse on my phone. And the verse was Matthew 11:28. Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. It's just good to know that God's always close with us, especially when we're going through the valleys. But I was asked to do two things. One was for Bob's best friend, Charles Rauch. He has some medical issues going on, or else he would be here. But he asked me to read a letter that he wrote, so I'm going to read that, and then I'm going to end with some verses that Bob wanted me to read. It was four of his favorite verses. So I'm going to try to get through this letter. Just bear with me. My friend, my brother, they say if you have two or three real true friends in your lifetime, you're greatly blessed. To those here today, Bob Leader may have been husband, dad, son, grandfather, poppy, brother, uncle, pastor, missionary, neighbor, or friend. To me, he was my friend. my very best friend in life, except for my wife, and he was my brother. Not in a human way, but we were close enough, we could have been. You see, the blood that made us friends that were closer than brothers is the blood of Jesus Christ. We were sort of like David and Jonathan in the Old Testament. My friend Bob, my brother, I never had a brother until you came along. I remember that day clearly. Through God's providence, we sat next to each other in that Bible college classroom at Baptist Bible College. Being the formal, fine-cultured guys we were, we met with the typical, "Hi, I'm Bob. Hi, I'm Charles." Neither of us had any idea of the great lifelong friendship the Lord had just begun. We didn't know anything about each other, only that we were young preachers called by God to go to some foreign country to preach the gospel and show people how to be saved. My brother, my friend, you and I were ready to win the whole world to Christ in a short time. That very day, in that college classroom at Bible Baptist College, we were teamed up together and assigned the task of developing a missionary slide presentation. I remember we borrowed slides from a missionary from Brazil to make a presentation for Zambia. Actually, if I remember correctly, you borrowed them, but I agreed, so we won't tell anyone. My brother, that has been almost 40 years ago. Like you told me a few weeks ago, it's been a good run. Yes, my brother, it certainly has been a very blessed journey. We worked together during college. We spent untold hours praying together, preached together, taught the Word of God together, won souls together, talked hundreds of hours, caught a few fish along the way, and drank an ocean of coffee along this journey. Sure enough, my friend, my brother, you made it to Zambia long before I did. But when I did get there, you had left a wonderful mark for Christ and the gospel that still lives on today, growing and multiplying. Many won to Christ, churches established, and some of those men are preachers today. Many of your converts have preceded you to heaven, and what a joy it must be you're having with them right now. Over the years, you and Matula came to visit us in Zambia, always bringing supplies and never letting us pay. What a blessing you both have been. My brother, my friend, what a rich legacy you have left behind. You laid up treasures in heaven, and those are eternal dividends. I can just imagine that right now you are walking those streets of gold. I've never imagined you as a dancer, but now I can. Dancing with the Lord and freely breathing heaven's pure air, as hundreds and hundreds of converts run to greet you, welcoming you home, and thanking you for bringing the message of the gospel to them. Iron sharpens iron, and a few weeks ago you reminded me, "Brother, heaven is only one breath away, and either way we win." My brother, one of the greatest impacts you have left us all is also that you were genuine. You weren't perfect, but you loved God, and you, like David in the Old Testament, were a man after God's own heart. You loved your growing relationship with your Heavenly Father more than anything in the world. You were surrendered to His will, and you've truly learned what it means to walk in the cool of the day, or to walk with God in the cool of the day, much like Adam did in Genesis. You loved to pray and read God's Word for many hours a day. Bob, my brother, you were what we call the real deal. Many times we prayed together and even wept for the salvation of family and friends. Now, brother, my friend, like the Apostle Paul in the New Testament, 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 6 through 8, when he said, "The time of my departure is at hand. I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me on that day, and not to me only, but unto all them that love his appearing." My brother and my friend, you finished well. What a legacy, what a heritage you left us all. I wonder in this room today, what will be our legacy? What heritage will you leave behind? What eternal treasures will we send ahead? My brother, my friend, by the grace and mercy of God, he gave you life, he sustained your life, and now he has received your life back to himself and given you that promised eternal life. life without pain, without suffering, without struggle, to breathe, and life with eternal treasures and reward, until we meet again, my brother and my friend. Bob had four verses. These were his favorite verses that he wanted me to read. It's the first one, 2 Samuel chapter 22, verse 33. God is my strength and my power, and he maketh my way perfect. Psalms 17:15. As for me, I will behold thy face in righteousness. I shall be satisfied when I awake with thy likeness. Hebrews 2:9. But we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor, that he, by the grace of God, should taste death for every man. And then the last verse he had was 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 9. But as it is written, eye hath not seen, nor ear heard, neither have entered into the heart of man the things which God hath prepared for them that love him.
Shauna, come on up. Share what you've got.
Going to try to do this. Thank you all for being here today. Me and my family really appreciate it. I titled my letter My Superhero because that's what he was to me. Strong, faithful, never wavering, kind, loving. These are just very few of the words that describe my dad. He was truly the greatest man I ever knew. I honestly don't think he knew a stranger. Whether we were out to eat, shopping, or even the hospital, he made friends wherever he was. But it wasn't just him making friends. He witnessed to everyone he could about the Lord. Even on some of his toughest days, when he was in the hospital, he told every person about Jesus. When I would be upset or wishing he was doing well, he'd tell me that maybe it was just so one of them needed to hear about Christ. And if that's the case, then he'd do it all over again. That was his heart. He tried every single day to follow what God wanted and to live a Christ-like life. The past 2 years, as he got less mobile, he told me that it was some of the sweetest time of his life because he was just able to spend so much time in God's Word and talking to his Father. 2 weeks ago, we thought that God was calling him home. His smile was huge. I'm sorry. And he was reaching out to somebody. God let him stay for just a while longer. And when he could, he told us he saw a glimpse of the other side. He saw my little cousin and was able to tell her mama that she's okay. He saw his grandparents and others that had gone before him. The most amazing thing, though, that he talked about was the two angels that were there to escort him. I said, Dad, describe them. He told us there was no way he could, that they looked like nothing he could imagine, but that they were absolutely glorious. There's a million things about my dad that I could share. His love to fish, hunting, his jokes. The way he loved his grandchildren so fiercely. All the amazing things he did in his life, like baptize in the Zambezi River with two men standing watch to smack away the crocodiles. Or water rafting on the famous Victoria Falls. There's simply so much about this amazing man. I could be here for a week and I wouldn't scratch the surface of it. I'm sorry. But the thing he would have wanted me to share the most was his love for Jesus. If he could tell us right now, he would say, don't cry for me. I'm running on the streets of gold and I can breathe. He finally got to ask Timothy if he made it to Paul before winter. He got to sit and talk to one of the greatest missionaries, Paul. If he right now, he wouldn't. Oh, if he could have stayed, he would have. Because that's the man he was, to be here for us. Now, though, that he's there and in his glory, he would choose to stay. The most important part is he finally got to see his Lord and Savior. I can't even comprehend the joy that he felt in that. While I am broken, my family is brokenhearted, and we honestly aren't sure how to do life without this pillar of our family. I'm also so happy for my daddy. He told all of us this past week he would see us at the mansion. Actually, every single night. He told my mama, I love you, I'll see you in the morning, or I'll see you at the mansion. His heart was longing for his true home. He always reminded me this is just a stopping place to his actual home. His favorite things were coffee and ice cream. And he told me he bet there was the best coffee and ice cream up there. 29 years simply wasn't enough time for me. But honestly, I'm not sure it would have ever been enough. So instead of focusing on the time lost, I'm so grateful for the time we had. 7 years ago, God could have taken my dad. But he allowed him to stay, and because of that, he met 4 grandbabies. He walked me down the aisle and married me to my husband, Dylan. He got to see the Chiefs win one more Super Bowl. And more than anything, he got to love on us all a whole lot more. So through my tears, I'm smiling over his amazing life and the peace he has now. Thank you again for all being here. He would have appreciated it, and we certainly do.
Appreciate these remarks. Bob had a heart for God. There's no question about it. And he lived each day to serve the Lord. Of course, God wants to get us all like that, where we think about him, meditate on the Lord, and try to reach other people. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for these testimonies and the sharing of personal information. Thank you for the scripture readings. Lord, might your hand of blessing be upon the family at this hour. Comfort them. Give them strength, Lord, beyond themselves. Once again, we pray your blessing upon the remaining part of the service. May your name and the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, be magnified in our midst. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Not afraid.
I think that song selection, Bob's trying to tell us something, that in the arms of the Lord, he wasn't afraid. Dying was the least of his fears. He knew where he was going when he died. He hated to leave his family behind and his friends behind. And the reason he wasn't afraid to die is because of the promises that we have in the Word of God. Promises like this. Jesus said, "I'm the good shepherd and know my sheep. My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. And I give unto them eternal life, and they shall never perish. Neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. My Father, which gave them me, is greater than all, and no man is able to pluck them out of my Father's hand." Bob knew he was secure in the Lord. And to pass from this life, it was only to pass into the next with his Lord. And that's why he continually read the Bible. He continued to draw strength from the promises that's in the Bible. And quite honestly, each day he read it, I'm sure the stronger he became. And so today, if it was not for the Lord Jesus Christ, the promises we have in God's Word, it could be a very sad, sad time. But because of what we have and the promises that we have in Christ, that moves it from a sad moment to a joyous occasion when we can see him again. And so I trust everyone here knows Jesus Christ as their personal Savior. I assure you, he wants you to know Christ as your personal Savior. Bob had a missionary heart, and by that I mean he cared for lost people. And he wanted everybody to be saved and have the same salvation, same assurance that he had. And so if you've never given your life to Christ, make sure that you do it. And look forward to the day that you'll get to see Bob once again. May the Lord add his blessing to the remaining part of the service.
Kind of homesick.
Does he say, "I'm kind of homesick," as the song said, for Beulah Land? He's now there. And in that we can rejoice that he's safely home. When I think of Bob Lever, I think of a missionary. I wanted to use a scripture that might reflect my thoughts. And so I chose Isaiah 9:2, a prophet that lived hundreds of years before the Lord Jesus Christ. And he says in Isaiah 9:2, "The people that walked in darkness have seen a great light. They that dwell in the land of the shadow of death, upon them hath the light shined." And then Isaiah, as he looks through time, finally sees the light that's going to be revealed, the truth, and the answer that these people who sit in darkness, who's looking for the light. Isaiah continues in that same chapter, "For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given. And the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace." We just celebrated Christmas, the birth of the Lord Jesus Christ, the light that Isaiah was even talking about. "They that walked in darkness have seen a great light. They that dwell in the land of the shadow of death, upon them hath the light shined." Jesus said, "I am the light of the world. He that followeth me shall not walk in darkness, but shall have the light of life." Jesus came into the world. We just celebrated that. And unfortunately, so many in America as well as around the world can't see the spiritual significance of Jesus Christ's birth. But Bob Leader sure could. And he acted upon the light. There was a day when he walked in darkness. And he came to that light. And it changed his life. That's what Jesus Christ does for a person. As they grope around in darkness trying to find answers to life in this world, no one's going to find the answer to life without the light. Jesus is the light of the world. He gives you wisdom, he gives you knowledge, he gives you understanding of life and heaven, the future. Bob found that. And then he had a heart. I believe God laid it upon his heart to take that light to others so they could also see the truth of life. And after having received the light himself and receiving Jesus Christ as his personal Savior, Bob felt a call upon him from God to take the light of Jesus and his word to Zambia, Africa. Why Zambia, Africa? I asked Charity, and she said, "Well, because Bob found out there was no Baptist Bible Fellowship missionaries there. He wanted to make sure that somebody got the message to the people. So he went. And he began to lead people to Christ through the preaching of God's word. He established a church which continues to shine the light of the gospel on those who walk in darkness. Bob was successful in bringing to pass the conclusion of that verse in prophecy, which says, they that dwell in the land of the shadow of death, upon them hath the light shined. And so Bob helped shine the light on people who might not have otherwise ever had an opportunity to know the truth about heaven, salvation. How do you gain heaven? How do you obtain salvation? Bob Leader sought to take that message and took the Word of God and took it to a people that he did not know, as far as him benefiting by it. He went just to be a blessing to them. Matter of fact, gave up probably some many comforts here to do that. But nevertheless, people started getting saved and baptized. They started a church. I understand he started three works there in Zambia. The works are still going. I think Bob and Charity stayed in touch with the people at the churches, and so that's encouraging. That the people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. They that dwell in the land of the shadow of death, upon them hath the light shined. And it's wonderful that a person will just go and give up everything here in America and take off and go to a foreign country. But he did. David, the psalmist, he wrote this in Psalm 119, 105, "Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path." So we get light, we find out about Jesus Christ in and through the Word of God. That's why he read the Bible so often. And the more he read, the more he grew. It compelled him to share the light with other people. And has been said today, everywhere he went, whether it's hospital or any place else, he witnessed for the Lord Jesus Christ. Why? Because he was sharing the light to people who sit in darkness. Used to be you'd have to go to a foreign country to reach people who did not know about Jesus Christ. But America is becoming such a mission field. You wouldn't believe that America, people in America, need to have, they don't even know about the light. They don't know about Jesus. They don't know about the promises of God's word. You'd think everybody in America would know that, but they don't. But anyway, he went. And I thank the Lord that he did. Like I say, he had a missionary's heart. Quite honestly, Jesus himself was a missionary in a sense. He left heaven to come to this earth to a people who sat in darkness. I'm glad he did. I'm glad Jesus did. He gave his life to redeem us from our sins. Sinners can't get into heaven unless they've been redeemed, unless they've been forgiven of their sins. This was the message that Bob took to the world. You can't get to heaven just like you are, is what he's saying. Jesus says, "I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me." And so I'm so glad of how God used Bob to reach people for Christ. And he's still preaching it here. Matter of fact, I really appreciate his willingness to preach here. Sunday nights he'd preach the Word of God, turn the service over to him. Always did a good job on his messages. And so he was a constant witness for Christ. You see, Isaiah's prophecy was fulfilled in the miraculous virgin birth of Jesus Christ, which is God manifest in the flesh. Jesus was God in the flesh. Today, Jesus is changing the world one person at a time as they call upon him for the forgiveness of their sins and accepting him as their personal Savior. Elsewhere in the Bible, Jesus says, I'm the resurrection and the life. He always refers to himself. See, salvation is in a person. It's not in us. It's not in how good we are. It's in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's why Bob felt compelled to take that light and that truth and that knowledge to people who would not otherwise know that. One of these days, Jesus is coming back to earth to fulfill the final part of Isaiah's prophecy. Isaiah went ahead and said, and the increase of his government and peace shall be no end. Upon the throne of David, upon his kingdom, and to establish it with judgment and justice from henceforth, even forever. Jesus is going to come one day and he's going to set up his kingdom and he will rule and reign. And the children of God get to rule and reign with him. How wonderful. Like I say, Isaiah prophesied that hundreds of years before Christ was ever born. And then when Jesus was born, he began to do wonderful miracles. He spoke like no one else spoke. He was captivating when he spoke. He was compelling with his comments. The message of Christmas is that Jesus Christ reigns and will guide the history of the world to its final conclusion. And in the end, Jesus will have the final say. He will redeem the world. Kingdom of great joy is coming. Recall at Christmas time the angel's message to the shepherds. And the angel said unto them, fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. Good tidings to all people, anywhere in the world. The appearance of this great light was a profound event with eternal implications. Why? Because it was grounded in eternity. The eternal Christ came from eternity past into our present, that he might be, that we might be with him in eternity future. The message of Christmas is multifaceted. But one facet is this, is that God is the sovereign ruler of the world. A sovereign is one who has complete and supreme power and is answerable to no one. God runs everything. God is God. And God laid out the plan of salvation. And he says, if any of us want to go to heaven, it has to be in through my son, Jesus Christ. Neither is there salvation in any other, for there's none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. So Jesus himself proclaimed that he was the way. The apostles preached the same message, that there's no other way to God except through Jesus Christ. In John chapter 14, verse 6, Jesus said unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh to the Father but by me. So Bob was faithful in his message of proclaiming the Lord Jesus Christ. And there'll be a lot of people in heaven someday who'll look to him and say, thank you for bringing the message to me. Thank you for sharing that. Now, Bob's body is here, but his soul is no longer here. His soul has departed and gone to be with the Lord. In the scriptures, the Bible says, we're confident, I say, and willing rather to be absent from the body and to be present with the Lord. And so those who respond to the light have a better life to look forward to someday. Bob Leader's enjoying it today. Now, a person can get through this life without giving their heart and life to Jesus Christ. They can somehow make it through. But when it comes time for your final breath, that's when reality sets in. You're either saved or you're not. You're either going to heaven or you're not. That's why he says, in the arms of Jesus, I'm not afraid. It's comforting to know that you're in the hand of the Lord. Nobody can pluck you out of the Lord's hands. And you're there because you've confessed your sins. Father, I know I'm a sinner. I know I'm lost. And you've given your life to Christ and asked for forgiveness. The Bible says, and God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. There shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. One of these days, God's going to do it, make it all over. He's going to make everything nice, and there'll be no Satan, there'll be no sin, more hatred, no more fighting, no more wars. How wonderful that is, and that's all made possible to a sovereign God who said this is the way it's going to turn out. And his great act of mercy was in the fact that he offered his son, Jesus Christ, as the perfect sacrifice on Calvary's cross to take care of our sin issue. Revelation 5:10 says, thou hast made us unto God kings and priests, and we shall reign upon the earth. Bob's enjoying Beulah land now. No longer does he have to say, I'm homesick for that land. He's there. The reality is there. Right now we walk through eyes of faith. But there it's reality. You get to see it. You get to see the Lord himself. You get to see loved ones that went before you that had gone the same way through faith in Jesus Christ. And I'm sure Bob would want us to point those things out to you, because that's what he pointed out to other people. It's the same message, it's the same light he would take. And I'm sure if we could hear from him today, he'd say, I want you to share the light to people who sit in darkness. I'm glad there was a day I sat in darkness. I didn't know the truth. I didn't know how to get to heaven. But a preacher got up and preached and showed me the way. And God spoke to my heart, and I accepted Christ as my personal Savior. I trust that everybody in his congregation has done that. If you haven't, Bob Leader would want you to. He'd love to see you someday. We've talked about Christmas. It's interesting when you think about it. Bob Leader just had his first Christmas in heaven. Let me share a poem. I've had my first Christmas in heaven. A glorious, wonderful day. I stood with saints of ages who found Christ, the truth, and the way. I sang the glad songs of redemption, how Jesus to Bethlehem came, and how they had called his name Jesus, that all might be saved through his name. We sang once again with the angels the song that they sang that blessed morn, when shepherds first heard the glad story that Jesus, the Savior, was born. Oh, dear one, I wish you had been here. No Christmas on earth could compare with all the rapture and glory we witness in heaven so fair. You know how I always love Christmas. It seems such a wonderful day with all of my loved ones around me, the children so happy and gay. Yes, now I can see why I loved it. Oh, what joy it will be when all my loved ones are with me to share in the glories I see. So dear ones on earth, here's my greeting. Look up till the day dawn appears. And oh, what a Christmas awaits us beyond our partings and tears. His Christmas in heaven is a little different. I'm sure there they celebrated the birth of the Lord Jesus Christ. And Christ was the central theme of Christmas. So it's kind of interesting that he went at Christmas time and he spent his first Christmas in heaven. He'd love to spend Christmas with you someday. And I hope that you'll be there and do that. So Bob's, like I say, his body's here. One of these days God will give him a new body to go with his soul. There will be a resurrection. But there's an eternity out there. And Bob certainly made preparation to enjoy eternity through his faith and trust in Jesus Christ. I thank the Lord for the fact that I got to know Bob. He liked to laugh. You could kid him. You could joke with him. He enjoyed life. And he's humble. He'd talk about it. He'd say, anybody else struggle? I struggled today. He'd just tell you right out front. Life wasn't easy. But on the other hand, he did his very best to live for the Lord and be what God would have him to be. That's all any of us can do. Really want to be what God wants us to be. So he leaves a wonderful legacy behind with regard to his faith, his love for his family, grandchildren. I mean, that's who Bob was. He could have fun, but his family and eternity meant everything to him. And so my point is that his, down deep in his soul, he wanted to take the light to people who maybe didn't have opportunity to see the light and to come to Jesus Christ, who said, I am the light of the world. And so there's people in Africa, and they're still getting saved over there today through the church that they started. And those people over there are witnessing of the light. And it continues to keep on flowing and flowing, and more people give their lives to the Lord Jesus Christ. So when I think of Bob Leader, that's the kind of a person I see. Someone who had a heart to glorify the Lord and to love people. Love his family. Love the church family. And so I hope you always remember his heart to do good, to reach other people beyond himself, and to be what God would have him to be. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, that you used Bob in a wonderful way to fulfill Isaiah's prophecy, to take the light into the world where people did not have the light, where people sat in darkness. And there's people still in the United States today that sits in darkness. They can't comprehend the truth of Jesus Christ and how he can change their life and make something wonderful and beautiful out of their lives. I pray that everyone here today has trusted Jesus as their Savior. Or if they haven't, they will. They'll make a commitment in their heart. Lord, I want to be saved. I believe what the Bible says, that Jesus Christ is the way, the truth, and the life. That he is the light of the world. And that every one of us someday will be able to fellowship with Bob Leader again. Thank you, Father, so much for your promises. Thank you for your love and your mercy every day. The grace that you give us. We give us another day to make the right decisions in life. Might your love and graciousness comfort the family at this hour. Give them strength even beyond themselves. Lord, that they can rest in the fact that Bob is in good hands and he's enjoying himself even today with no more pain and suffering, no more heavy breathing, no more oxygen problems. Now he's enjoying life as God, you intended us to enjoy from the beginning. And so, Father, again, we thank you for what's been said today. Thank you for your word and your promises. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I dreamed of a city called glory, so bright and so fair. As I entered the gates, I cried, "Holy." The angels all met me there. They carried me from mansion to mansion, and oh, the sights I saw. But I said, I want to see Jesus, 'cause he's the one who died for all. I bowed on my knees and cried, sang glory to the Son of God. I sang glory to the Son of God. As I entered the gates of that city, all my loved ones, they knew me well. They led me down the streets of heaven, and all the scenes too many to tell. With Mark, sat down with Timothy, but I still said, I want to see Jesus, 'cause he bowed on my knees and cried. I clapped my hands and sang glory, glory, glory. I clapped my hands and sang glory. I clapped my hands and sang glory. I sang glory. I clapped my hands and sang glory. I sang glory to the Son. Yeah.